Generation Z describes those born between the years of 1995 and 2009. That places them in their late teens and 20s today. Now, people in this life stage are often viewed as a bit of an enigma by other generations, particularly those older than them. They wear different fashion, they listen to different music, and at times it can feel like they speak a different language. While their age does play a role in some of these generational traits, we believe it is a mistake to view generational characteristics as merely a life stage or a fad that people will outgrow as they age. Because generations do not change over time to look identical to how, say, their parents looked at the same age, but rather a generation is a product of their current age, their times, and importantly, the formative technologies and social markers that uniquely shaped them. In many ways, people actually resemble their times more than they resemble their parents. So, joining me today to discuss some of the characteristics of the generation they belong to are two of my very Gen Z colleagues, Luke Davies and Holly Schaaf. Welcome, both of you, to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. Thanks, Ash. Great to be here.
Thanks for having us.
It is, for both of you, your first time on the podcast, so I thought it might be helpful for our listeners to get to know you both just a little bit better. So Holly, let's start with you. Could you explain to our listeners what your role is at McCrindle?
Yes, absolutely. Thanks, Ash. So as she said, my name is Holly and I'm the advisory executive here at McCrindle. So that looks like managing all of our advisory and media engagements here. I get to work alongside Ash quite closely, which is a joy as well. She's one of our advisors who often goes out and, you know, does speaking engagements and engages with the media. So it's been a lot of fun. I just started here in October of last year. So in the first few months, and I'm absolutely loving it. It's a wonderful place to be.
We are loving having you on team, Holly. Because this is a mostly auditory platform, I feel like also let's just clarify on the record, what is your accent? I know that you sometimes get mistaken for different accents. Where are you from?
I am from Canada. I feel like 99.9% of the time I get that I either sound American or Irish.
The Irish is so random.
Yeah, because I don't know if it's the maybe an Irish look, which I know, sorry listeners, it's not very helpful right now to try to explain the Irish look, but I don't know, some people have said my dialect for some reason sounds a bit Irish, so the listeners can confirm if this might be true, but I am from Toronto, Canada. I've been living in Australia for just about 6 years now.
Love it. Love to see that. So that's Holly and Luke, also your debut on the podcast. Welcome.
Yeah, thank you.
Would you like to tell our listeners what your role at McCrindle is?
I'd love to. My name's Luke. I've been at McCrindle for two and a half years now. It's interesting that you only say half when it's like you would never say 10 and a half years. Anyway, 2.5 years now. I'm the marketing executive here, and so I help produce and organize our content and getting it out into the world, and then helping our clients find their ideal research solution, whatever that might be, whether it's advisory and speaking or projects or demographics or other stuff, like kind of managing these different channels to help our clients find what they need, both like existing clients and future clients. Love it. It's great.
Love it. And again, for some great, you know, accent diversity, you also have an accent, Luke. Would you like to elaborate on where that all started, where you were born?
Sure, yeah. So it all started when I'm originally from the UK, from a small town called Basingstoke. Which is like outside of London.
Shout out to all the listeners in Basingstoke.
Yeah. I've heard this podcast is huge there. And I've been here like in Australia for like seven years now. So yeah.
Great. Well, both of you are a big asset to Australia and a big asset to McCrindle. It's very fun to be working alongside you each day. The three of us, just for some context for the listeners, we all sit in the same row at McCrindle. So we get to spend a lot of time together, a lot of fun. A lot of generational banter, as you might be able to tell in the podcast today, takes place between us. So let's begin by talking about the fact that, as I mentioned in the introduction, that both of you belong to Generation Z, the generation born between 1995 and 2009. I'd love to hear from each of you, but let's start with Holly.
Yeah.
what you think makes Generation Z, the generation you belong to, different to other generations.
Yeah, I think the first thing that comes to mind with me, particularly with Generation Z, is just with the advent of social media and technology obviously being such an integral part of our lives, it's interesting being on kind of the older side of Gen Z. So I'm only within, you know, the first couple of years of Gen Z happening. And I feel like I remember those days when social media was just beginning to take off and I wasn't allowed to have a Facebook page. So you definitely had to, you know, say you were born perhaps in a different
13.
Year. Yeah. Wait, oh, yeah, that too. And just kind of remember that life did exist pre, you know, social media and all that kind of stuff, but kind of have that really be an integral part of my early, you know, teenhood and going into my young adult years. And it's just an interesting, I guess, comparison if you're contrasting that with Generation Alpha, so the generation that's after Generation Z, who social media and technology and everything that's taking place today is all that they've ever known, you know, all the Apple products and all that sort of thing. But then also compared to the back end of the millennials as well, where you fully remember a life that existed outside of social media and technology and all that sort of thing. So I feel like Generation Z, and maybe particularly that older portion that Luke and I are in, yeah, but in an interesting space where we can kind of, I guess, sympathize with both sides. Where it's like, oh, we remember life before all of this, but also can't really imagine life without it. That's, yeah, I guess kind of just the first thing that comes to mind for me, that for something that's a bit different.
Yeah, it's great. I feel like, I think I've said this before on the podcast, that sometimes if you're closer to when a generation starts or ends, you're kind of described as a cusper and you can identify with characteristics of both. And I sometimes like make the joke in presentations that those people can just choose on what day it is, what generation they belong to. If you're being bagged out, you're like, yeah, no, I'm not Gen Z, I'm Gen Y.
Not
and
today,
then vice
tomorrow.
Versa. Exactly. Yeah. Not today. Cool. Thank you, Holly. Definitely technology, a big defining trait of this generation and formative technology. How about yourself, Luke? What do you feel like makes Gen Z different to other generations?
A few things. Firstly, I find it interesting that in your intro you described, I think you said something like Gen Z are often seen as a bit of an enigma. Mm-hmm. And I find that fascinating that they could be perceived that way, because of all of the generations who are like publicly putting themselves out there, like on a global and like shareable scale, it is Gen Z. Like,
yeah,
you could almost like, if you want to understand them, just like find like any TikTok or Instagram with the Gen Z and you will learn a lot about them. just because like of how free they are to share things. But anyway, that aside, a few things, like interestingly, and we touched on this with like research from McCrindle, is that they're a global generation. And I was saying to Holly earlier, like my dad, he's from a really small town in Wales. And then he moved to my hometown, which to him is like a bigger like city. Like it is a bigger place. But to me growing up there, I was like, oh man, this like tiny, boring town. And so I wanted to like uproot and move to Sydney. And it's like that, I guess, that influence of like growing up with the internet, like I'd heard about like the lives of other people on a very normal basis. Like I remember when I was a kid, I used to play Minecraft and watch YouTube videos of like American people playing Minecraft. And so
it's
very
Gen Alpha of you, Luke.
I know. Look, I was a front runner of the Minecraft kids. But it's like growing up, I was like, oh, I'd love to go to America because I'd heard about it at like a day-to-day level from these like people on YouTube. And therefore, like, I just like, it's just that global integration of things. Like you're always aware of like what's going on in the world and it's so shareable.
Yeah.
And it's not like things you get at a high level from the news. It's like, yeah, TikTokers and Instagram accounts and YouTube and like daily postings of what's going on in the world. So yeah, definitely like that global community, like it's all one cohort in that sense. And the other thing, which I think every generation has this trait, is that they're not accepting of norms. Like the idea of like, you see on TikTok, there's a lot of stuff of like, why do I have to do like a 9-to-5? Or like just rolling their eyes at this idea of a 9-to-5. And I know that every generation has challenged like norms and the way things are done. But I think, I just see that a lot in Gen Z, is like not having to do things a particular way. There's a few thoughts.
Great. I agree though with your comment earlier around the fact that they're an enigma is interesting, because they are the generation that posts so much about their lives more than any other generation. And I wonder if it is because perhaps older generations aren't on TikTok. Like, if they did the initiative to go on, they could, you know, get on to that. Like, I feel like even for me, like, I learn a lot about this generation and a lot about the language that, you know, you young people speak, you know, that sort of thing. Like sometimes I feel a little bit proud because I'm like, come in and I'll say, you know, Gen Z term, and you're like, oh, Ash, like, great, where'd you learn that?
Yeah.
Like,
yeah,
from TikTok.
She's been studying,
Whereas I've got other... I've got other friends who, like, be like, oh, Ash, you're too old for TikTok. Like, there's almost this, that's not for us. That's their community. So you're right, Luke. I definitely do think if people took the initiative, like, there are platforms where you can learn a lot about them.
Yeah. Or, like, I'm thinking about the fact that Facebook, like, when I was a teenager, all of my friends were Facebook. And then, like, the mums joined Facebook and everyone left Facebook for
Instagram.
That's true. It was like, all the mums, like, you're not going to post stuff, like... I would like, because your mum would see it. And then we all moved to Instagram. And then, like, I feel like that's, we've managed to keep a lid on that.
Yeah.
But then everyone's moved to TikTok, and it can get pretty unhinged. Because, like, I think my mum doesn't have TikTok. Like, she wouldn't think to, like, use that.
No, my mom made a TikTok for our dog. A TikTok
page.
Oh,
yeah. That's funny.
Honestly, it's not taken off, but we hope the best.
But, yeah, it is a gold mine of information, but I guess the, like... You just keep migrating until it's like just the people you want there. So
yeah.
And I think one thing maybe even about that, because you're right, like young people, especially if you're in a teenage life stage, like you don't want to be on the platform where your parents are, like
that sort of
thing. And maybe TikTok is maybe what's different. It's a different platform, but we've talked about this a little bit, you know, within our office. The algorithm is like hypersensitive and so sophisticated to the point that like you could be seeing a completely different set of videos and interests from your friends and family because it tracks how long you spend on different content and then it feeds you more of that, which has got some challenges in and of itself with regards to having different perspectives and those sorts of things. But the platform itself is different. But as I mentioned just before, part of the I guess the thing that I learned about Generation Z and that I keep learning keeps me, you know, current TikTok is about the slang and the language that, you know, young people or Gen Z are using. And it's interesting because I feel like every generation goes, oh, yeah, you know, we invented this. And then you actually do the research and you go, actually, every other generation's had their own slang, their own terms that they use when they were young that made them seem very different, you know, their parents. So it does keep evolving. But I feel like for Generation Z, again, because of what you've both shared already, because of social media and technology and that they're global and they're digital, it's just kind of been exacerbated and there's more terms than ever before and they're constantly changing and the rate of change and the pace of change is so much faster. I remember, I think, Holly, we were watching this TikTok video recently, which was poking fun at Gen Z. It was like a Gen Z breakup and we're watching it and we're like, yeah, it's so true. Like great, you know, insights into the language. So maybe we'll, you know, share that link if anyone wants to go and find out about Gen Z slang, but also let's just do the hard work for them in this podcast and talk about some of the slang that is current for Generation Z. So I thought we could help our listeners use this and we can see, you know, what the context of different situations is so that they know how to converse with people, you know, of this generation. So would you like to take it away? Maybe Luke, I know you had a bit of a bit of a list compiled of some of the slang terms.
Been waiting for this
moment. We prepared a list.
And he's prepared it on pen and paper, very unlike, you know, Gen Z.
I know. He's going against everything we've talked about with being completely, you know, enamored with technology.
Okay, so do you want me just to read these out and then I'll read them out and then we'll ask you a few questions we'll pick a few out and ask if you know what they mean and then
let's do a public quiz on how well I know these terms.
Off the
cuff. This is a pop quiz. Ash is being graded.
All right. I look forward to my grade at the end of this episode.
Yeah. We'll let you know.
Okay. I'll just read them all out and then we'll take it from there. So here are some Gen Z slang terms. Slay, queen, riz, stan, extra, energy, ghosting, dead, glow up, slaps, cap, bussin, iconic, simp, drip, sus, snatched, finesse, yeet, and toxic. Just to name a few.
Just a small list.
just a quick overview. No. Okay, so Ash, which ones do you want to...
I feel
should
like...
Should we start with like that?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, Ash, what do you think soleil means? And please use it in a sentence.
Use it in a sentence. It's like a spelling bee.
Yeah.
Spell it and use it in a sentence.
S-L-A-Y, slay. Okay. I feel like slay is to, well, the traditional meaning of slay, I guess, is like to kill something, like to slash or whatever. So I kind of feel like it does draw on that original term of like to kill it, but it's positive. Like it's a term of like, oh, you've nailed it.
Yeah.
Well so done. If you posted a photo in an outfit that I thought looked good, I would say slay.
Slay. Yeah, is that a good context? It's a very encouraging term. Yes, absolutely. Yeah. That was a great definition, Ash. Thank you.
And I feel like it's especially prevalent among girls.
Yeah.
Like, I would never say that to like a guy friend, like a male. I'd be like, slay. I mean, it's just a bit. It's a bit sus.
But slay, no, I feel like that's, Ash, even the example you use. Like if you see on comments of people's photos, slay, let's just be clear, they do not want to kill them.
Yeah.
It is a very encouraging, very positive term that someone is just looking great.
And two things I would say about slay is one, I feel like it's withstood the test of time. Like there's some terms that are really, you know, popular for a few months because again, like TikTok trends, they're changing like every week and new terms and that sort of thing. But I remember even like we would put slay in as like Gen Z slang like 5 years ago. So it's withstood the test of time.
Yeah.
The other thing I would say as well, just around the context is that there's this viral video of some audio. I actually don't know where it's originated, which is classic TikTok. Like you just don't know where it came from originally, but it's now used to all these different, you know, trends. And it's a person being like, slay the house down, partial slay. And people often use it to talk about like Oscar, you know, outfits or rating books or you can apply it to anything, but it's kind of like, it's like a slay scale.
Anyway. Slay scale. It's amazing.
The SS.
Yeah.
So yeah. Right. Okay. Pass on that one.
Should we do this one?
Yeah.
Okay, cool. So what do you think, stan means? And try and use it in a sentence.
Okay. I would say that stan is kind of like maybe like, I don't know if this is where it comes from, but like I think it sounds like stand, like we kind of stand behind, we support.
Oh, yeah.
So it's like maybe, use it in a sentence. I don't know, like we stand this decision. Oh, I don't know.
Yeah, no,
is that all right?
That's pretty good.
It is very good because the funny thing is that like the definition, where it came from originally was that Eminem had the rapper Eminem had a super fan named Stan.
And there was a song about
Stan.
Really? I did not know that.
But your definition is actually aligned with what the meaning is, which is essentially that you just really support, like that you're very supportive of something, but almost to the nth degree. That's why Stan was like a super fan. So if you were really loving, you know, a particular person or place or you'd say, oh, I stan Sydney.
Like we support.
We support. But what you're saying with stan or like really support a decision, you could say I stan that decision.
I
so
stan that,
that's definitely not incorrect.
We stan that. It's like third person, like we stan that.
Yeah.
Like,
but it's almost as if you're using the name Stan when you say it.
Yeah.
Although which is funny because it's based on someone named Stan. Like,
based on someone named
that's
Stan.
So funny.
Yeah. So.
And it's interesting because that was a slow burner because that song came out in probably like the early 2000s. That
gonna
Eminem
say,
song or like maybe
Eminem,
99.
Eminem like, is a like hard and fast millennial artist.
Right. But then it's like, it just goes to show like anything can get picked up, like anything can get swept up into the vocabulary.
Yeah, the vocab, it's all susceptible.
Yeah, all right,
the Gen
Z's. Let's move on. Shall we do, are we doing that one?
Sure.
Or
we'll do
one?
A couple more,
We'll do a couple more. Okay, so cap.
Actually, this is what I was...
nervous.
You can also like it can also be used as like no cap.
Oh, I genuinely I this is probably the one that I don't know. I mean, if I had to guess, maybe something like I can only think of something maybe like captain or caps lock, like extreme.
Yeah.
But that's I could not use it in a sentence because I know I would use it incorrectly.
Wait, can you use it in a sentence? Like,
that is cap.
Yes.
Oh.
That's cap. Like, or
cap.
He's capping.
Yeah. I need, I feel like I need more context. I feel like maybe, doing well or supporting, like, capping makes me think, like, I don't know. Clearly don't know. Yeah. Zero out of ten on this one.
You know what? I appreciate the efforts. You really put some thought into those responses.
Maybe too much thought.
Yeah. Luke did actually give me a history lesson just this morning on the term cap.
I want to explain cap. So the use of it is to say whether someone's like lying about something or not, or their authenticity behind something. So if I said, like, as an extreme example, say I said, he says he's a millionaire, but actually we think he's just capping. Like, you're saying, like, oh, I think he's, like, lying. I think he's being inauthentic about what he's saying.
Yeah.
And the phrase originates from rappers who would get gold in their teeth, like, you know, like grills. If it was a fully gold tooth, that's no cap. But if it was plated, it's just a cap of gold. It's not fully gold. It's not fully like authentic.
Right.
So to say if they're capping, it means that they've actually just got caps, that it's not fully gold. So that's the development of like where that came from. But even these days on TikTok, if someone's like making a claim about something, you'll see in the comments just a bunch of the blue like baseball cap emoji to say like, oh, he's capping. So it's like, it's completely evolved from like gold teeth to a word to now an emoji.
Yeah.
And like if I see, like, if someone replies to a message with a blue cap, you know
what it means.
Yeah, they're not trying to, like,
which is interesting,
they're not trying to say baseball cap, they're saying like, oh, he's capping, he's lying, or
it's got a quite associated meaning to that.
Yeah, very different.
yeah
Maybe we'll do one more.
So you
sit. Okay, Ash, for the final one, you can get extra points here.
Yeah.
Snatched.
I feel like we've had a conversation about this and I actually can't remember.
I was going to say, I thought we spoke about this.
Holly's like trying to help me out. You're like, I gave you the answers off mic. Again, I just think about the literal meaning with this one. Like, I can't, I don't have any context or examples. So I just think snatched, like taken. So, but that seems way too straightforward. So I do not know. Please explain.
Do you want to explain it? And then I'll tell the
Because snatched, snatched. I mean, that is correct. Like, snatched, that is a meaning.
It can be used in that context.
It can be used.
Still understand the original.
It is, I would say that's kind of one of the words, unlike, you know, even slay, where it's kind of kept that its original meaning, although it has a more positive connotation to it, if that makes sense. This has a completely different meaning, where snatched can now also just is understood as like someone who's fit. Or just like, you've gotten snatched, like you've been, you know,
working out,
or like that kind of thing, like looking toned. So I think snatched is associated with toned, or if someone, so I guess that's the best way to describe it. But what's funny actually about your response, and I feel like encompasses a lot of this
summarizes. So there was like a Twitter thread where someone was like, it was at the beginning of the year, and they said, like, this year I'm trying to get snatched, like I'm like. They just said that, like, this year I'm going to get snatched. And then, like, a few hours later, they had to reply to that tweet and be like, by the way, when I say snatched, I mean get healthy. I'm not looking to get abducted. And it was just, like, the confusion of some people, like, why do you want to, like, why,
like,
why
are you get asking abducted? To get snatched? So there's a good example of that in practice.
It just completely changes the meaning of the whole tweet.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah.
No, exactly,
yeah.
Exactly. So.
Yeah, yeah.
We'll end it there.
Okay.
I think you did great, Ash.
Yeah, look, room for improvement, but lucky I've got you two in my life to help me on this.
No worries.
We talk about slang just then. I think the other thing that sometimes I get asked in presentations and things is even the use of emojis. And I've definitely noticed in chats with both of you individually and collectively, the use of the skull emoji.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
What is that about? I mean, I feel like I know now because I've seen it in practice, which again, I think goes back to Luke's comment. Like, you see, like, I've seen even new slang terms come up. I'm like, what is that? And then you need to see it used in like a few different contexts to understand what the meaning is. So I feel like I know, but I feel like it could also be helpful just to hear it from the Gen Z perspective. Why are people using the skull emoji? Why are Gen Z's using it? And in what context are they using it?
Take it away.
All right. So the skull emoji is meaning dead, aka skull, but in like a humorous way. So if something's so funny, that you're like, oh my gosh, that's so funny, I'm dead. That's why you would use a skull emoji. Mm. Except it, once again, it's in a very positive way because it's in the sense of something being so humorous that you just can't even take it, you've passed away. And in the same way, there's like the grave emojis used in that same context. So very rarely when you see a Gen Z or anyone younger using the skull emoji does it ever mean anything negative associated with death. It's always very positive, lighthearted.
So kind of like... not literally, like they're not using literally. They're using it like,
yes, yeah. It's very, yeah. It's just this metaphorical thing. Kind of, it's, I feel like it's the evolution from LOL, like laughing out loud.
It's gone from LOL to then the laughing with like the face with tears of joy emoji. That's now, it's that just, no one used that if you've got a Gen Z in the group chat.
Exactly. Yeah. And to now the skull, but also Ash, as we were talking about before as well, now it's also evolved to the crying emoji, not to be confused with the crying laughing emoji. The crying like tears where it looks like someone who's just absolutely devastated also means that someone found something so funny that they're crying from laughter, but it needs to be the streams of tear emoji coming down, which is just so interesting.
And thinking about it, it's just the evolution of saying, like, I'm dying of laughter.
Yeah.
Because like, you can think, like, oh, they use the skull emoji. That's such a, like, dark sense of humor.
Are you guys too young for ROFL? Do you remember that acronym?
Oh, no, rolling on the floor laughing.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's,
you're
it's
like,
all
don't
funny.
Use that, sweetie. No, don't use that, Ash.
No. Oh, that's sweet. We love that one. Oh, yeah.
Do you use that with your friends?
Yeah. Oh, that's cute.
Yeah.
No, it is interesting, though, how it's all just different ways of saying, oh, me telling you that I found that funny is not enough.
Yeah,
I need
to
be like, I'm literally dying. That's so funny.
Yeah.
Or I'm rolling on the floor laughing, like, you know. But now it's just emojis saying more with less.
Yeah.
Okay. Noted. Duly noted. Highly noted.
Highly noted.
Okay. We've talked a little bit about this as well, because obviously, like, the places where Gen Z are interacting, these things are like breeding grounds for some of these terms to be used, or influencers to put them out there and they catch on and then everyone uses it in this context. And I feel like, yeah, it's almost like if you know how to use it, you know, that shows that you're part of this. It's almost like a sense of belonging if we're going really like deep into it, which is a healthy thing. And a lot of that is on places like TikTok. We talked about even some of the social media evolutions, like from Facebook to Instagram to TikTok. I got asked this actually recently at the end of a presentation. Someone said, "Is what's the newest platform? Where are the Gen Zs?" I said TikTok. Is that correct in your opinion, in your professional Gen Z opinion?
Take us
a look. I think TikTok is the current one. And yeah, like similar to what you were saying about Slay, like it stood the test of time in terms of like, it's just like it's spun up and it's still going. But interestingly, we were speaking about this earlier, the fact that it's almost not so much like what is the current platform, but like the broader thing to know is how quickly like you are able to jump onto a new platform. So there was one last year that became huge, was Be Real. And for the uninitiated, basically everyone downloads the app and then you add your friends, that like obviously your friends, and then every day at the exact same time it sends you a notification to take a picture of wherever you are, and you have 2 minutes to take that picture. And so the idea is that you're being real about where you are at any given time. And so like say at like midday every day, or one day, like everyone takes that picture and then everyone can see what everyone was doing at that time. And I feel like it's kind of plateaued. Like it certainly doesn't have the same engagement as
definitely
like TikTok
not.
Or Instagram.
Yeah.
But no, I think TikTok's the biggest one at the moment.
For sure.
And in a general sense, just to comment on like Be Real is a response to that like curated, perfect like content thing that has happened. Like there's an expectation that things have to be perfect and look great. But then Be Real is about like being real. Like you can't fake where you are at any like at a random
at a
moment.
Given
like,
time
your life is not always
it.
Perfect. So it's like it's a response to that idea.
Yeah. What's really interesting about that, actually to tie into what Luke was just saying, but even, you know, potentially an earlier point when we were talking about what, you know, makes Gen Z stand out from the other generations, is this push towards authenticity and this real driving factor of, no, we want to see in both, you know, personal context, professional context, whatever it might be, this authenticity being played out in the public sphere, essentially. And so a big part of that is with social media, which is why it's so interesting with things like Be Real coming up, you know, where the whole premise of it, exactly what you said, Luke, is trying to drive away from this curated perfect life that, you know, someone could make up on Facebook and on Instagram. And I feel like even a couple of years ago, there was that real drive of influencers posting things about their daily lives where they're like, oh, this picture was edited, but here's the real one.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's this whole idea of real life versus the highlight reel that is social media.
Yeah.
And then how Be Real was kind of meant to be the response to that, but how Be Real actually became curated.
Yeah.
And I was even just mentioning this to them before that there's this whole idea of Be Real, people kind of waiting for the time to actually be real, or as soon as Be Real goes up, okay, everyone, fix your hair, you know, how can we make it look cool, bring in that thing and this thing, like it's actually became curated.
Yeah.
And yeah, Luke and I've had an interesting chat about this recently, actually, this whole idea of, you know, wanting authenticity, but actually leaning towards curation.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like there's a big draw towards TikTok because it feels more authentic. I even saw this TikTok earlier of someone putting down their phone a certain way, and it's like, oh, this will show you the difference between a Gen Z or TikTok or a millennial TikToker, is because the millennial TikToker will start, have it all set up and start talking as soon as, you know, it already is going. Whereas the Gen Zer is setting it down in place as it's recording, trying to make it look like it's just kind of happening in the moment.
Yeah.
And so it's really interesting how TikTok kind of encompasses this move towards authenticity. But even how platforms like Instagram perhaps are getting a bit left in the dust in that wake, because it's like, okay, people aren't really being authentic on here. It's a lot more curated. And we were laughing even earlier about how even things like photo dumps, which is very Gen Z, and to clarify what a photo dump is just a collection of photos. I'm guilty of this, I'll admit that. It's a collection of photos that you just kind of take at random. It could be like a really zoomed in picture of your pasta.
Pixelated.
And the more it looks set up and unprofessional, the better. Like, you know, the super zoomed in pixelated, and how that's actually meant to look like a move away from curation, but how that actually is in a lot of senses more curated
that is now
than a posed picture, because that in and of itself is aesthetic. And so it's just interesting to see with social media platforms like TikTok that are really taking off, this balance between trying to be authentic, but also almost this gravitational pull towards curation in social media as a whole. It's almost like it's hard to escape, and it's just kind of being outworked in different platforms. But yeah, definitely would agree that TikTok is the most prevalent platform with Gen Zers for sure. Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it's, as you were saying that, just around as the platforms evolve and what is getting traction and how the people or the demographic, you know, mostly using it want it to be used. I definitely have seen that. And like for me as a millennial, it was very much, you know, Instagram was like your highlight reel and curated and filters. And then it seems like TikTok was even tried to be a bit of a move away from that. But it's less, TikTok in some ways is a bit less of a social platform and it's more about like a consumption of content and humor and upskills. Like it's almost anything that's a short video rather than like here are photos of what I've been up to lately, more the creative kind of Vine-esque vibe of trends, it seems to me. But yeah, you're right, Holly. I remember us talking about this even with Gen Zs. Like I look at the people in my life who are Gen Z and their feed, and it's very like intentionally blurry photos, and like nothing wants to be too perfect. But the irony, I guess, is that even those ones that look really candid are kind of staged in some way. So like you said, like as much, it's almost like just innate in the platform, like that that social media is that it's fact that it's media, that it's never really purely authentic or in the moment.
It's even funny with the blurry thing, because I saw a TikTok the other day that was like the best apps to make your photos look candid and blurry. Like it's like, let's just curate it more while trying to look like we're curating it less. It's so interesting.
I have such a sad story to share because I was like traveling the other day and I was taking a photo of something, and I was like trying to make it blur. I was like, how do these Gen Zs make it blur? The camera really quickly. Just like no idea how to do this.
That's so amazing. It's like, I'm just going to look like I put no effort into this, but really it took me 10 times longer than it would have had I just taken the picture nicely. It's a real place.
So funny.
We can help
give me the apps later. But I think the other interesting observation, and, you know, I think because, like, I remember actually, Holly, you saying this, you know, sharing this within our team, because you haven't been on on the team at McCrindle, you know, for as long as others of us. And mm-hmm. I find this too when, you know, we talk about demographics, so you talk about generations. And I remember recently there was a famous celebrity that like my family member had met, and I would tell people their story, and I could really pinpoint, it's like anyone who was a Gen Y knew who this celebrity was, but anyone who was a Gen Z had no idea. It was like a blank face. I'd be like, who? I'm like, it's so weird. And I was telling this story about this distinction that I had realized to another friend of mine, and they were like, why are you talking about people in generations? I'm like, oh, doesn't everyone do that? Like, apparently not everyone is talking about people of a certain age as Gen Z, but we obviously operate in this space a lot. And so I find that I tend to try and observe things. And I mentioned this to you just last week, Holly, that I had this observation. We were in a meeting and we were having a call with a prospective client, and we were kind of evaluating them and sussing them out. Yeah. Did you like the use of that word sus there?
Yes. Well,
heard that in your one, Luke, in your list. But and we came across their website, and, you know, no judgment, but it was quite outdated and looked a bit old. And you made this comment, Holly, where you said, oh, I really don't trust them because of this website. And I just feel like it was a really unique insight about, I guess, people of Gen Z, because you could have so easily just said, oh, their website looks a bit old and outdated. But you were like, I don't trust them because their website is so old. And I guess I would agree with that too. I am a few years older than both of you. I'm technically of a different generation. But I evaluate companies based on their, I guess, social media presence. And I've probably shared this before. I know I've shared it with our team. Like when I'm traveling and I'm trying to find somewhere with good coffee, I will scope out Instagram for the cafe's vibe. Like I'm trying to do a vibe check, because I'm like, you can read their reviews on Google, but that doesn't give me as much of a picture about who they are or their aesthetic. And I do believe that, you know, coffee shops that have a nice vibe serve better coffee. They care more about it. They put more effort in. So it's interesting how we equate value with these things. Do you have any reflections though on that, Holly? Just, you know, that was a comment that you made. Do you feel like that's quite descriptive of people of your generation, around how an organization presents themselves actually determines whether you'll engage, but also how, like, the level of trust you have in what they're trying to sell to you?
Yeah, no, absolutely. And it's so interesting because I don't even think I would have necessarily recognized right off the bat that that was something that my generation or would have thought until we had that discussion and you highlighted that, because to me it just felt so innate to see that and be like, oh, you know, it is a bit outdated, and to each their own. But for me personally, as, you know, the potential consumer, there is such an emphasis within Gen Z specifically on aesthetics, which is once again an interesting tension that you have there with the draw towards authenticity, but then also this pull, it appears to be, with curation and with aesthetics. Because I feel like I've found this in both, like, personal life, like amongst relationships, but even in, the professional sense, where in when it comes to people, you look at someone's Instagram and it could be so well curated and aesthetic, which I guess to describe aesthetic in this sense, it kind of is just very clean and has a great look to it. It's very, you know, put together. There's photos that almost the colors blend together nicely, and you can tell there's a lot of thought into it. And there's certain, you know, presumptions that you could make about that person just purely based off of their Instagram. They look like a cool person. They look like they, you know, they're trendy and they'd be fun to hang out with. But in reality, it's actually not really telling that much about the character of this person, who they are, you know, all that sort of thing. It's just purely based on what their socials look like. And I think in a lot of senses, that same mentality is drawn naturally over to the professional sense, with a brand sense, with how Gen Z consumers are engaging with brands. Is if they go to their website or they go to their socials pages and all they're seeing is, you know, this mismatched content and it just all looks a bit all over the shop or looks outdated, there is a natural tendency for some reason within the generation to not trust it as much, even though in the same sense as seeing someone on Instagram and they look so cool, but in reality they might, you know, not be as cool as they look. A brand could actually have great value, and then it just, you know, is being presented with a more old-fashioned, you know, style of website. So it's not necessarily that the aesthetic does equate to the value, but to us it just naturally lends itself toward that way, where it's how it looks, how it presents itself, the aesthetic and the look of it and how curated it is does equate directly to value. So when I see something and I see it is a bit more outdated or doesn't have, you know, like you said, doesn't pass the vibe check, in a lot of ways, it does have this natural, like, oh, I don't know. Yeah, I don't, I don't know how I feel about that. You know, why have they not invested perhaps into updating their socials? Even though the reality is not everyone thinks that way, you know, everyone puts that much. That typically has not perhaps been an emphasis on generations past, is that those sorts of things actually did make such a was such a deciding factor when it came to consumer impact. So it is interesting moving forward, recognizing that is more of a Gen Z sort of thing, and interesting for, you know, marketing professionals like yourself, Luke, and people who work, you know, in brand design, all that sort of thing, to actually be aware of how much Gen Z is actually paying attention to these things, paying attention to socials pages, websites, the look of it, as actually a deciding factor of the value that they're going to place on the organization before knowing anything about them. Whether that's right or wrong to do, I'm not sure, but it is actually just something that I could say I relate to. I know, Luke, we've talked about it, and a lot of people within my age do feel very similarly and will interact similarly with that.
Yeah.
And interestingly, off the back of that, I'm just thinking now, because I was talking about how it's like a pendulum that swings. For every, like, is it like curated aesthetic, there's the then like the uncurated aesthetic. And even thinking about like user-generated content, like I see brands that like use TikTok well do it where they have like their actual customers doing like reviews or like using products. Like that's where influencer culture came from. Like it's you, like a big brand will pay an influencer to use a product or, and not even promote it, just to be seen using it is like seen as a way of like therefore promoting it. And, but it's not that like, it is obviously still curated, but it's not that aesthetic use because it blends into like everyday life. Like it's not as like prettified and like organized as you might like assume a feed to be, like an Instagram feed. So it is interesting that there's just such a range of like, the brands that do it well are the ones that blend it in with like their users and their audience and their content base. Which is like, that's a huge thing in marketing, like user generated content and repurposing that.
Yeah, absolutely. That sort of third party validation rather than you just shouting, like the brand shouting, we are so good, come and buy from us, totally. Or engage with us. And I think what you've both shared reminds me of something that we talk about in our presentations about engaging with the future customer consumer, which is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. And we'll often put that up on the slide at an event. And I make the joke and I'm like, oh, it's probably something you've never seen before at a conference, Maslow's hierarchy of needs. Everyone's like, yeah, obviously we know what this is. but then what we do, which I find quite helpful and we get a lot of good feedback about, is we break up the hierarchy and we start at the bottom, which is survival and security. And we would like black out the other components of the pyramid that are higher up. And we talk about the fact that, you know, historically consumers would think about purchasing a product or engaging with an organization, and it's the survival and security things, like what's the price of this product? You know, is it well priced? What's the guarantee? What happens if it doesn't work? Can I return it? Some of those bottom line aspects. And those things are still important to people today. But there's more considerations thrown into a consumer's decision. And it's those things like the social aspect, like what's the shareability of this? What if I, you know, what is this brand saying? What does it say about me if I post about this brand? What's this saying to my network? Yeah. Like if I'm supporting them, if they've been cancelled or if they've been known to not do things ethically, and then I say I support them, then all of a sudden I'm attached to that brand. I think the same can be said even for an organization's website. Like there's more things that are being considered now rather than just what's the price of this. It's actually what's the vibe and those sorts of things. And then even those higher order drivers at the top of the pyramid, which is historic, like, well, traditionally in Maslow's hierarchy, self-actualization. It's even things like what's the ethics, what's the sustainability practices, what's the impact on the environment, the ESG considerations. So there's a lot more that brands need to navigate today with future consumers. And I feel like, even just this story highlights that to me again in practice, which is helpful. And I guess, you know, this is the Future Report podcast and we always like to think about where things are heading. So I'd love to just hear, as we wrap up, any final kind of thoughts that from each of you that you feel like our listeners or people maybe of a different generation should know about Generation Z, but also I guess like where some of these trends maybe might be heading, what you see, these things, you know, the oldest Gen Zs now, which you guys are more of the older part, are in their, you know, mid to late 20s. I was at a conference recently and someone said the older Gen Zs are starting to have kids. Like, that's very much happening. Yeah. We're not just talking about teenagers anymore. Yeah. So where do you think some of this, all these trends are heading for this generation? Holly, start with you.
Sure, yeah. One of the most overarching things that I guess just in this conversation about generations that I feel like is important to take away is just to not, I guess, take lightly the implications of each generation and what their characteristics are and what their distinct behaviors are. Because I think in a lot of ways and conversations, you know, generations can be seen a lot, almost, we were laughing before, it's like a horoscope where it's like you have this thing set out for you and it just, you know, it, you have to behave all these certain ways and whatever. And it's not like that. Like, there's specific life events and things that contributed to why generations and certain cohorts between, you know, this year to this year behave a certain way. And I feel like I would just kind of leave with the listeners the whole idea of not taking lightly the behaviors of Generation Z, what their consumer patterns are looking like, what, you know, the behaviors, the sort of things that they do differently than the generations that have come before, but also look distinct from Generation Alpha, because like you're saying, Ash, these are the ones who are kind of entering into the workforce now, in out of uni, going into the workforce, having children, are going to be, you know, parents and all this sort of thing. And there is research that obviously we do, and there's some interesting things about each generation that really do set them apart. And I just feel like this is not something that should just kind of be brushed over as, oh yeah, that's just the stereotype, that's just who they, you know, but actually take seriously, what does this mean for our organization? What does this mean? These are the people, you know, even Generation Alpha, you know, soon will be having that consumer buying power and all that sort of thing. You know, Generation Z have been holding that for a little bit there as well. And just this whole idea of, yeah, like, what are the implications of this for my organization personally? How can I actually leverage the opportunities and the challenges that do come with Generation Z being such a important part now of the society and of everything that's going on? And what organizations can actually do to prepare for what this is going to look like? And
great wisdom, great feedback there for anyone listening. Thank you, Holly and Luke.
A few thoughts. It's interesting, coming off of what you were saying before about purchasing decisions among Gen Z and that idea of, is it Maslow or Maslow's hierarchy? How do you say
Maslow with a W at the end.
In Maslow's hierarchy of needs, there's like the safety and security and then the things like that working its way up. And I was even thinking about the fact that with Gen Z, I feel like, when I think about, like, my grandparents' parents, they would have been, like, post-war, like, rebuilding the world. Like, we've been through this crazy situation. And then, so for, like, my grandparents had been like, okay, like, get a good job and, like, provide for your family and create, like, a safe space. And then, like, we know, like, we talk about this sometimes with the team. Like, in terms of history, it's such an incredible time to live. Like, prosperity and medicine and technology. Like, we've never been in, like, on all metrics, technically a better place to live than we are right now. And yet among like Gen Z, there's such an issue among like mental health and well-being, things like that. So coming back to that, like purchasing power, I feel like Gen Z, they actually have so much security in life that there's almost like no struggle to come up against to like build that resilience. Where was I going with this? Oh yeah, they've been given so much resource that it's like, they'll have to learn, like, what do we do with all of this abundance and resource and how do we live meaningful lives? So I'm really excited and interested to see how Gen Z fill their lives with purpose and, like, what they then do. And we see that more and more, like, they're less inclined to work just for a salary, but they care about the purpose behind it.
Yeah.
Like, that's part of the reason that I wanted to work at McCrindle, was because it's about empowering leaders with insight to, like, run good organizations, not just, like, I get a salary and I take home and provide my family. And even like the Gen Z research we did last year, that only 14% want a traditional job. Mm-hmm. Only 14%. Mm-hmm. Like, that's crazy. Like, the amount of, and like, obviously that's more like desire than actuality. Like, they will probably get to the workforce and realize, oh, actually this is mostly going to work if we work 9 to 5, Monday to Friday. But at least the like idealization that I couldn't do other stuff. Like, I'm free. Yeah. Like, there's so much information. And there's a... He was a British mathematician, but also did philosophy. Bertrand Russell. He said, how a society fills its leisure time is like the last challenge of a civilization, or something like that. Like, how you fill your leisure time is like the last challenge. It's like, in all of this abundance, in all of this free time, with things like AI taking jobs, like, how you fill your time will be really interesting for Gen Z in a meaningful way. And then I think a final thing for, like, in terms of the leaders of Gen Z, we were talking about this, how, especially on things like TikTok, it can become a bit of an echo chamber of, like, ideas circulating, and that can, unfortunately, most of the time, can be like a spiral downward in terms of, yeah. like, you've heard of the use of the dead emoji. It's like kind of like ironic and sarcastic. And so I think it'd be really good to see, like, Gen Z leaders, like, leading their cohort through, like, I don't know, into like a life of meaning and purpose and, like, to, like, achieve and do great things. And it's interesting, as I was just, like, doing a thought experiment in my mind, it's almost like it can't come from, like, a hierarchy power. Like, they have such a distrust for governments and politicians and corporations that it's, like, it has to come from within them, like a self-elected leader to, like, lead them through times to, like, like, lead them into new things. So, and I guess, like, for leaders leading Gen Z, it's like coming alongside them and, like, helping them through things is probably more effective than, like, telling them what to do. Because they probably don't trust you, unfortunately.
No, but that's actually a very good point. Like, just one last quick thing with that as well, is there is such a significant emphasis at the moment, particularly with Gen Z, with the inner psychological self as being able to dictate, your life and your meaning and all that sort of thing. So that's a great point that you bring up, this whole idea of not having trust and authority, but actually having someone to come alongside you. Because there is such an emphasis on that internal life. People actually need guides to help them navigate that, rather than try to push them away from that, if that makes sense, because there is that distrust naturally that if, you know, what typically in generations past, you know, different authorities in life were dictating how people should act and the meaning they should have in their lives and the sort of jobs they should work and why they should work them, because we know that that doesn't necessarily work anymore, it is, just kind of that you don't, it's not going to be very beneficial for them to keep trying to do those things and then they just retaliate against, but to recognize they actually are led a lot by their feelings, which, you know, can have its pros and cons for sure, but dictated by feelings, by this inner sense of meaning. That's where this authenticity comes from, is this inner sense of my authentic self and who I am and who am I as a person. And so actually having those mentors more than dictators to come alongside them and actually bring out, what do you care about? What are your passions? How can you leverage that in your life and actually do things that give you joy and bring benefit to the people around you? Instead of just that instruction, because it's just, with Gen Z, and I assume as well with Gen Alpha, it'd probably be quite similar there as well, that there is a lot of that inner dictation. So having people to help with that.
Yeah, for sure. I think we've talked a lot about, in the Gen Alpha book, and also had Mark on the podcast before, about, you know, the changing styles of leadership and the things that worked for our parents and our grandparents, command and control, hierarchical, was really appropriate for the context of the time that they lived in post-war and that sort of context. And it's a different one now that Generation Z are being shaped in. It's a lot more collaborative. It's a lot more, they're more empowered than any other generation has been to kind of have their voice heard, and it's just kind of go and do it this way or get over it is not the right approach. But the need for wisdom and mentors, I think, from within their own generation, like you said, Luke, but even beyond that as well, because I think what you were saying, Luke, is that Gen Z, you know, they don't have the life experience or the perspective that other generations have, even with regards to, say, like the recession that we may well enter this year. Like, we've done a lot of research even a few months ago around how stressed people are, and Gen Z were expressing a lot more stress than other generations, which makes total sense because they've never lived through anything like this before. But other generations have that perspective to go, okay, well, the economy and global societal events are not just a straight line. It's up, downs, there's challenges, but they'll come back up. Yeah. So the patterns. So I think it's really helpful For leaders of any context, whether you're in a family and you're leading Gen Z or in a community group or an organization or even a workplace, to be able to acknowledge the times that have uniquely shaped them and the language and the slang and all the things that are a bit more fun, but also, I guess, at the deeper level, where this generation are at in their life and how they've been shaped and how you can help them. And it is by getting alongside and inspiring them rather than instructing and commanding just to get over it. So, yeah, really, really helpful, I think, point or note to end today with regards to, addressing a few different maybe listeners, but very encouraging, very fun conversation to have. And I think I mentioned this already, but it's very special as well to have both of you on the podcast, but also Holly, because you are normally behind the scenes on the podcast. You're yes. an amazing producer now. So yeah, it's great to have you on the other side. But thank you so much to both of you for your time, for, you know, upskilling me and the listeners all about the Gen Z slang. It's been such a delight to have you both on the podcast today.
Thanks, Ash.
Thanks, Ash.
It's been great.
And if you would like to stay up to date with McCrindle's latest insights, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media or visit our website, which we hope is very Gen Z friendly, which is McCrindle.com. So as always, thank you so much for listening and goodbye for now.